funny. Okay, Jesus, help. Because I really, 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 really need it. I had direction that went out the window. People always ask me, they're like, you look tired, man. People pray for me just recently. They're like, you need to slow down, man. You're tired. What they don't understand is that I spend most of my life in tears. My eyes are swollen because I can't stop crying. It's not a tears of where I'm bummed out or burnt out or any of that. I just see something really clear. And I believe that we've complicated it in the body of Christ. And we complicate it. And it's not complicated. It's simple. And I really believe that we have to see the simplicity of this gospel, or we're striving to try to get to some place that we already are. I believe that I see righteousness in such a way where, since I've been a Christian, you know, I had that 5.5 month period that I kind of briefly went over with you guys yesterday. But I didn't know him. I incorporated Jesus in for what I could get from him. But I didn't surrender who I was to him, because surrendering who you are to him changes everything. The Bible says to hunger and thirst. And sometimes we've hungered and thirsted for gifts because we've been taught to earnestly desire the gifts over the reality of what you're supposed to hunger and thirst for. And I'm not against the supernatural, but it should be a byproduct of being a son. And so we're supposed to hunger and thirst for... Are you recording on there? Hello? You're supposed to hunger and thirst for righteousness. And in my life, I met this guy when I first got saved. And when I saw something in his eyes... And I couldn't get over the reality of what I saw in him. And when I asked him what it was, he told me, well, it's my lamp. And I said, all right, I need more understanding of this, because he said his eyes are a lamp. So I'd listen to him preach, and the guy's name was Dan Moeller, and still is. But I was so amazed. And the day that I went in from the church, to the church, you know, I told you guys, I think I did. I was suicidal, wanted to kill myself, thought of it my whole life. I mean, thought of running off the road, hitting a tree, whatever. Thought of it constantly. Told my girlfriend for 7.5 years, because our daughter was 7.5 years old, that if she ever left me, I'd kill her, whoever she's with, and then make her watch and kill myself. And that day when she left, and I drove over to her stepdad's house to get a rifle, instead of going to the gun cabinet, I went by a phone book, and I made a check at one of these 586 churches in my hometown. No, had no idea why I was doing it, and I drove to this church, and when I walked in, I said, I need to talk to somebody, and this guy's so happy. He's like, all right, buddy. And I was like, I'm not your buddy. Because it wasn't anybody's buddy, man, you know? And he's like, I need to talk to you. And I'm like, great. And he told me, he said, told me about Jesus. And I'm like, I don't care about Jesus. I'm not here to hear about Jesus, man. He's like, this is a church. I'm like, yeah, but the reality of it is in my life, I had no grid for Jesus being in a church. You're talking like about a guy that for 34 years, nobody told me about Jesus. Because everybody was so concerned about their own life that they weren't willing to step outside of their own life to touch another life because they really didn't know who they were. And people are like, well, you know, I don't share Jesus. It's not my gift. Well, you're wrong. You just don't believe. I'm not being mean. I'm being real. If you believe in something, you share with it. You share about it, especially since it's eternal and it's forever. That doesn't mean you have to prophesy over 50 people, but you should, like, if you're happy and you know it, use your mouth. So for 34 years, no one told me about nothing. And I meet this guy, and he's possessed by truth. I don't know that it's truth because I think that what I feel is truth. I think that actually in my life, I thought this world is hell. I mean, if there's a hell, I'm in it. Because in my life, I was the freight train for the kingdom of hell, constant. All I did was destroy and had the black cloud. I was like Pigpen on peanuts. Everywhere I went, there was a cloud around me and everything I touched, it fell apart. And everybody I was around, I hurt. So I saw this guy. And the thing that caught me the most were his eyes. And I could hardly look at him because there was something inside of there that I'd never seen before. And it was crazy because I live in the same world that you live in. And I found it in my Bible in Matthew 6. It says that in Matthew 6:22, it says the eye is the lamp of the body. And if your eye is single, your whole body's full of light. But if your eye's not single, and the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? And light, dark, lamp, I didn't get any of that, the verbiage, none of that stuff. I didn't understand any of it. But one thing led to another. I said, fine, whatever. He's like, told me about Jesus. I'm like, fine, whatever. He can have my life. There, I did it. With cussing and all that. He's like, all right, amen. And I'm like, I have no idea what you're talking about. So what I did was I wanted what he had, but had no idea that what he had was him. And then for 5.5 months, I struggled so hard because I had no clue. And then I got shot at 5.5 months later. And Jesus, like, spared my life in the midst of a drug deal that I should have been dead in. And I went away to Teen Challenge, and 2 months later, I come home. My girlfriend had given her life to Christ. We get married. It's like a crazy dream. But when I was up there, God said to me, he said, I'm going to stamp a scripture on your forehead, and you're going to live by it all the days of your life. And it's in Matthew 6. And as you go through the chapter, in Matthew 6:19, you know, if you go through in Matthew 5 through Matthew 7, you've got all red letters. It's pretty safe to stay in there. And I've lived in those sections of scriptures for 11 years. And it's been a place where I've just lived. You know, it starts out in Matthew 5 with, blessed are those who are poor in spirit. It's amazing because blessed are those that are poor in spirit actually means blessed are those that don't think they know it all. That aren't spiritually arrogant and think they know it all and are teachable. But not teachable by man, but teachable by the Father. Teachable by man, but you better hear the Father when man's teaching, or else you might think that what a man's teaching is the reality of what that Bible teaches. But people get it twisted sometimes and they teach their own thoughts and they study the Bible to make it sound like what they want to. And you'll ride on somebody else's doctrine instead of the truth that comes only from the mouth of the Father, because Jesus said we don't live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the Father. And so if I don't have relationship and I don't have intimacy with God, I'll take what you're saying as truth. And I can't afford to live by what you're saying, because God doesn't want me to be an echo. He wants me to be a voice. And that's for everybody that's out there. Sometimes somebody becomes a teacher, becomes somebody that teaches in front of somebody because they're eloquent with their words. And I'm not preaching against anybody. I'm talking about the necessity for relationship and the necessity for you to be able to hear straight from your Father. People have taught that faith comes by reading. And faith doesn't come by reading. Faith comes by hearing. And you need to hear from God. You cannot go by what everybody says. You need to hear personally from God. So the danger of coming to church and just listening to your pastor or going to a conference and just listening to a speaker is that you will ride on their revelation, and that can only take you so far, even though it might be straight from God. The Bible says you have many teachers but few fathers. Sometimes we've elevated spiritual fathers above the heavenly Father. And we think that if we have a spiritual father, we'll never be an orphan. That's not true. You'll always be an orphan if God doesn't become your father. So Dan, when I started to grow in God after I came out of Teen Challenge, I told him, I said, dude, you're my, because there was all this talk about spiritual fathering, and there still is, and I'm not against it. And I said to him, I said, man, I said, dude, you're my spiritual father. Because there was people at my church that were like, you know, I'm supposed to disciple you, and there's no one else can disciple you, and I'm the one. And I'm just, it was weird to me when someone said that. And I was like, dude, you're my spiritual father. And he goes, Todd, I know what you're saying, and I understand, but you have to understand this. He goes, the Bible says in Matthew, call no one on earth your father, for you have one father. I said, yeah, but what about this teachers and fathers thing? It's true, a spiritual father is amazing, and we have many teachers and few fathers, but a true spiritual father will actually push you into a relationship with God as your father so that you're never an orphan. Because Dan used this example, and he said, Todd, he said, there'll be a time when you want to call me on the phone to get help, and I won't be there. And he said, and that answer on the other line is what you'd be depending upon, and me answering the phone will determine of whether you feel like an orphan or not. And that's a lie. So I said to him, I said, man, I said, the best thing, I said, the next best thing in my heart, I'm thinking, well, you're my mentor. And he said, Todd, I understand what you're saying. And I said, I'm not right, am I? He said, you're not. And I have so many people that email me and tell me that I'm supposed to be their mentor, and I'm supposed to be their spiritual father, and Dan said to me, he goes, Todd, he goes, if the Holy Spirit doesn't become your mentor, you're done. And I said, so what you're saying is you're neither my spiritual father or my mentor. I said, who are you? He said, well, some say John the Baptist, some say, no, I didn't say that. No. He didn't. He said, I'm your friend. He said, and a friend would lay his life down for his friend, and he defined friend, and I'm like, gosh, man. Okay, what do I do? He's like, go in your bedroom and seek God. I'm like, okay, I went in my bedroom, and I'm like, all right, God, I'm seeking you. No answer. It's the craziest thing, because I tried to get quiet, and I had no understanding of what I'm seeking. Yet I got this book. So I look at that scripture that God said he was going to stamp on my forehead. And I'm thinking, I look in the mirror and I don't see it, like, you know. But it's Matthew 6:33. And I looked at the chapter before it, and in Matthew 6, and it says in Matthew 6:19, it says, don't lay up for yourselves, you know, treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust can't destroy and thieves can't break in and steal. And I'm like, okay, he's talking about money. All right. But like, why would I can't lay up money in heaven. That's weird. So I keep reading, and it talks about the eye being the lamp of the body. And it says, if your eye is single, your whole body's full of light. Okay. And then I read a little bit further, and it says, you know, there's these birds. And I'm like, what? Really? And this is just the beginning of my life. This is where I started my life. And even though I rested in Ephesians 1, which is God wants to give to me the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, God wants to give to me. God wants to. That means that a man can't, God has to. But God wants to. And if I seek him, I'll find him. So even though I'd stay in there, and that was like a prayer of mine, it was a constant thing. I need to know him. And everywhere that I would walk, I would listen to Christians talk. And I would listen to people talk one way, but think another. And I noticed that there's so many people that were in my church, and it wasn't a specific bad thing where I'm thinking that someone's bad. It has nothing to do with that. It had to do with nobody had peace. And like, there has to be this simple answer to peace. You know, and I'm thinking about birds, and that peace doesn't matter to birds, like, right? I mean, birds don't think like we do. And it says, you know, consider the birds of the air. They don't reap nor store away in barns, right? Yet our Heavenly Father provides for each one of them. And then he uses this and he says, of how much more value are you than they? And I thought, wait a minute. I got value. My Father values me. So that absolutely 100% positively has to be a key in this life, because he uses this, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, I got value. Don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, I got value. Don't worry. And it kept hitting me. I'm like, okay, dude, I spent my whole life worrying. I spent my whole life in anxiety. I spent my whole life stressed out and freaking out about whatever. And I never had peace. And then, you know, I read in the Bible that Jesus wants to give me peace, peace that surpasses understanding. And I'm like, how can I have peace if it passes understanding? I get it. I have to give my right up to understand it, to have it. Okay. That's amazing. Really? It's just simple stuff. I mean, simple but profound, right? How profound is that? In order to have the peace that Jesus paid a price to give us, we have to give up a right to understand it, to have it. It doesn't make any sense to my brain, because my brain wants to understand it, to have it. So all of our life, we try to seek understanding. And it says in all your doing, get understanding. But the understanding that God tells us to get is different than the world's understanding. Colossians 3 says to set your mind on things above and not beneath. Wait a minute. Matthew said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be. So I'm to seek this. But when you get a little deeper, it actually says, his kingdom come, his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So I'm supposed to seek as it is in heaven and live from heaven towards earth on a constant basis. But first I have to have peace with God, or else I'll always be trying to strive to think like that, but never be able to. So since I can't be able to, I will do in order to be, and then I'll spend my whole life through works trying to do what I've already become. Okay. Consider the birds of the air. They neither reap nor store, and they don't store away in barns. Of how much more value are you than they? What does that mean? What does the value of something have to do with this? See, Jesus didn't pay a price on the cross to redeem the birds. See, in the world, the price that's paid for something always determines its value. And unfortunately, the way that we grow up in life and people and the appreciation we get from people, we allow that to determine our value. But in the cross and in Christianity, the value of you is determined by the price that heaven paid to redeem you. See, all my life, man, when I talked to Christians, or I heard about Christians, and even today, people still say that Jesus paid a price on the cross, and the cross is the revelation of my sin. But that's not true. See, the cross is the revelation of your value. When you see the cross, you see the revealing of your value, not the revelation of your sin. Something underneath of that sin must have been of high value in order for Jesus to do what he did. So the revelation of my value is everything. Otherwise, when I come to the cross, I'll always be a sinner. If I think that I will always be a sinner, then I can never be a saint until I get to heaven. But if I understand the revealing of my value, that God redeemed me from that life of being a sinner, he puts me into a different category. It says that he took me from darkness and he translated me to light. That I was here and then he put me here. If I don't see that, I will always think sinnerism. In my life, when I got saved, I was so twisted and so horrible. And what I saw in Dan's eyes was the revelation of righteousness. The revelation of righteousness is so powerful. See, I was sharing this yesterday a little bit. See, when I... When I came to Christ, I had no clue of anything. I just had no understanding of anything. And when he saved me, he set me free from me. He set me free from my thinking. He set me free from that old way that I used to think my whole life. And I'm reading this Bible, and I'm like, oh my God, this is amazing. God, you're showing me who I really am. And my whole life has been a lie. Every bit of it has been a lie. Every bit of it. But if I don't get the revelation of right standing with God, I'll never have peace with God. Romans 5 says that I've been justified by faith. I have peace with God. You cannot be a witness if you have no peace with God. Or you will do witnessing instead of become one. Romans, gosh, it's just so amazing. The whole Bible. There's so many things that are flooding my heart right now. So Matthew 11, 28. You guys have all heard it. I'm just going to go there and I'm going to talk about this and just hit this and pound this thing. I've lived in a place of rest for 11 years and I haven't had a place of stress, anxiety, or striving. Jesus says to strive to enter his rest, but once you enter it, you're never supposed to leave it, and life shouldn't have the ability to take you out of it. When I got born again, I went from sin consciousness to son consciousness. I was sin conscious when I came to Christ and had no idea what it was. I was at Teen Challenge. I was conscious of my sin. I was conscious of the life that I lived and all the twisted stuff that I went through. And then I became son conscious, and I was no longer conscious of my sin, but I was conscious of being a son. That changes everything. Son consciousness doesn't have a byproduct of guilt, shame, and condemnation. Sin consciousness, the only byproduct is guilt, shame, and condemnation. You're not a worm in the dirt. You're a son or a daughter that Jesus paid a price for. And if you incorporate Jesus into your life but not surrender your life, you will live in sin consciousness your whole life. But if you surrender your life and if you actually have trust in your Father, then God's ability to keep you is greater than the devil's ability to deceive you. Truth sets up its home right here. Boom. And all of a sudden, when you look in the mirror, all you see is truth. See, the problem with lies is that when you believe one, you believe many. The consciousness of sonship and the reality of rest is so imperative that no situation outside of you will have the ability to take away the reality of the peace that you have with Christ. There are 613 laws in order for you to follow, in order for you to be right with God. There's 10 commandments in addition to that in order for you to be right with God. If you transgress one of those 613 laws, you've missed them all. So there's no hope. The only hope is Jesus. And when you see the revelation of who he paid a price for you to be, then Christ in you, the hope of glory, becomes this revealed mystery. that God thought that you were worth it, so he sent his son to come and die so that he could be resurrected, and the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost came and changed Peter from this one that denied Jesus to one that was possessed by Jesus. The one that denied him preached his first sermon to 3,000, yay, without a microphone, which meant it had to be pretty loud. But Peter was an orphan and was twisted up and was whacked out as whack could be. The disciples that Jesus gave power to, by the way, they healed people when they weren't born again. Which is crazy. Which means that people can walk in the miraculous and really not know who they are. They wanted to blow up cities. They were like, they don't want you? Let's kill them. Just give us the word, James and John. Let's blow up. Come on, we'll kill the Samaritans. Let's do it. They reject you? Let me call down fire. Come on, they're pushing each other on the road. I'm the greatest. Shut up, I'm the greatest. No, I'm not. I'm the great. Lord! They were orphans. And you can't afford to think like an orphan and be a son. And nobody can take you into sonship except the Father. And if you see that you're a son and you see that you're a daughter, absolutely nobody can take it away from you. Here, I have been accepted, in Ephesians, says that I have been accepted in the Beloved. If I have been accepted in the Beloved, how could somebody take away what they never gave me? We've entertained a spirit of rejection for a long time, and the devil really is the one that's been rejected. And that's not your spirit. We've said, well, you don't understand. I get rejected. Watch. If God has accepted you, how can a man, a woman, a husband, a wife, a child, a boss, a colleague take away what they never gave you? People mock and scoff what they don't understand. But what they're mocking and they're scoffing is the reality of peace that you're supposed to have because you've given up your right to understand it. So what's it matter? You guys okay? This is really, really, really important. So Matthew 11:28 says, oh yeah, let me go there. Sorry. I have to find it. It's in here. It's just a couple of clicks away. It says, come to me, all of you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So we've got this rest that Jesus wants to give us. So when I surrendered to God, what happened was I came to him because this is the issue. This is the issue. Anxiety is a lack of rest. Worry is a lack of rest. Stress is a lack of rest. I promise you. And the Bible says, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then everything will be added to you. It's crazy. And God says, this is the scripture he's stamping on my forehead, right? When I'm in Teen Challenge. And I'm like clueless. I looked at it the day that he told me and I'm like, what is that? Like, I have no idea what that even means. You're stamping it on my forehead. I guess that means that my brain's going to get it sooner or later. But Jesus is like, rest, rest, rest. So I come to him, and how many people have ever heard it? You come to Jesus and your burdens and you're weighted down by all this stuff. And then all of a sudden there's that time, and people call it their first love, where you got saved. And lots of people can relate to this. You get saved and you're like, wow, I feel amazing. But then you don't enter into the second part. And so we live in that first part when we get saved, and then we coast through church. We never learn and understand who God says we are. And we try to live on that first part of rest, but you're not meant to live there. Take upon you, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come to me and I will give you rest. Bang. So we come to him. Boom, there I did it. No, but let's not forget the second part. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. That's where it's at, bro. Right there. Right there. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Jesus says, learn from me. He didn't say learn from man. He didn't say learn from your pastor. He said learn from me. And pastors are amazing, and teachers are amazing, and prophets are amazing, and evangelists are amazing, and all of them are amazing, and apostles are amazing. But that's not who you're supposed to learn from. See, them equipping you is different than from you just learning from them. See, I'm to equip you for the works of ministry, but you're not supposed to learn from me. There's a difference between learning from him and learning from people. If you learn from people, you will have an amazing ministry, but you will be like a person that is trying to make people codependent upon you to learn from you. And then when people appreciate you, you get this feeling like you did your job, but it's not about the appreciation of people. You can move in great gifting and people will celebrate you and you are awesome. You can prophesy the most clear prophecies, the most amazing words of knowledge, the most amazing everything. And you will look amazing in front of people and your gift will make room for you and you can preach at many things and you will have many doors open for you. But the problem is you're only as good as your last prophecy. And with Jesus, you're only as good as the price that he paid for you, and that determines your value. So it's not about your performance. It's about your relationship that never is supposed to end, because God will never shut it down on his end, but we shut it down on ours. And we move in gifting and we move in the appreciation of people and the stroking of people, and that makes our day. So if people appreciate me, I did a good job. But if people don't appreciate me, then I did a bad job. And that's just not okay. So Jesus says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. A yoke is like this thing where you have this oxen and you're yoked to an oxen, two oxen tread grain, and they have this thing around their neck like that. Imagine that, being yoked with Jesus, but really realizing who you're yoked to. And Jesus says, learn from me. So I was talking to Dan saying, dude, you're my spiritual father. And I thought, this is like neglect. Because everybody's talking about spiritual fathers and you have a spiritual father. You need a spiritual father and it's awesome. And I'm like, you're mine. And he's like, no, I'm not. And I'm like, yes, you are. And he says, no, Todd, you don't understand. The Bible says, call no one on earth your father, for you have one father. Okay, well, what's this other verse mean? He said, Todd, a true spiritual father will push you into a deeper relationship with your heavenly father so that you can be a son. Because it's not about me, you needing me to survive. He said, Todd, if you need me to survive, then what if I fell? Not that he's gonna, but your life is dependent upon me making it. If I don't make it and I fall, or if something happens to me, then all of a sudden your whole life is out of order and your whole life is whacked because you depended upon me instead of him. You're yoked to Jesus. And I thought, dude, this is profound. I have no clue what you're saying, man. But when I listen to what you're preaching, it is freaking me out and overwhelming my soul. So I'm like, okay, you know what? I'm just going to dive into the red letters. So I dove into the red letters and it says, hunger and thirst for righteousness, for you shall be filled. And I thought, okay, this is awesome. And I heard all the talk about the spiritual gifts and earnestly desire the spiritual gifts. But then when you really look at it, it says, but most of all love. Like earnestly desire the spiritual gifts, but above all love. I'm like, what is love? God is love. Jesus is love. The reality of the cross is love. See, nobody could do it for me, so he did it for me. Jesus, who knew no sin, became sin so that I might become the righteousness of God. Then he says, hunger and thirst for righteousness, for you shall be filled. I went, all right, I'm going to go after this thing. So God led me into a place of Hebrews. This is crazy. And I'm like trying to understand Hebrews, and it's an amazing book. I want to go there with you real quick, and I just want to define this a little. All right? Are you guys okay? What would it be like for you to have peace? What would it be like for you to rest? What would it be like for you not to worry and stress out? Oh, I've lived for almost 11 years now without stress. I'm not saying I'm above anybody. I just believe the simplicity of the gospel. I believe the simplicity of the price that Jesus paid for me, and I have not complicated it. And I won't allow the enemy to come in to speak lies to me, to complicate this thing and to make it works. It's not works. It's not. It's grace. But grace enables the truth to be revealed to me. When he says to seek first the kingdom of God, what is he talking about? So when I say kingdom, everybody thinks of power and authority. They do. When I say kingdom, they're like, authority, dominion. I got dominion. People are like, all dominion. Really, I got authority. And it's true. We do have authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and all that stuff. But what about the authority over worry? See, people say, well, you know, no, we get that. Let's move on to praying for the sick. The reality of having peace, being able to sleep, the reality of having rest for your souls. Jesus said, come to me and I will give you rest. You're burdened and weighted down. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am meek and lowly and gentle, and I will give you rest for your soul. Here is where it's at. This is what hit my soul in the beginning of Christianity, and it's never been taken away from me. And I've been through a lot of stuff. When you come to Jesus, you have this weight of sin that's taken off of you. It's just like this supernatural, oh my gosh, I feel so much lighter. But the majority of people stop right there and think they can go through life and live with that right there. And they cannot. Because if we don't learn from Jesus and understand who we truly are, and your identity isn't secure, you will have no rest for your soul. Your mind will constantly spin. So your soul, what? Let's define it. People say, well, you know, that I'm after souls. I get it. And so we want people to go to heaven is what we're saying. We want people to be in heaven. We want to depopulate hell and populate heaven. I get it. But rest for your souls is different. He's talking about your mind, your will, and your emotions being free and being saved. Set your mind on things above and not beneath. That's what he says. So my mind is supposed to have rest, is supposed to have peace, is supposed to stay in that place where I'm in this world but not of it. Where I'm a part of this world, but my soul doesn't receive rest from what's going on around me. I have peace in the midst of any storm because of what he's done inside of me. But if I don't fix my sights and if I don't fix my eyes on things above, that means that this Bible becomes the determining factor of whether I'm going to have peace or not. Not CNN. No newspaper has the right to take peace away from me. No person around me that's angry towards me has the right to take peace away from me unless I relinquish the authority that I've been given by the King to live in a place of perfect peace and rest. Now you're talking to a guy, or a guy's talking to you that has never experienced peace in his whole life. Ever. Ever. And I look into another guy's eyes at that church that I went to, Dan, and the light that I saw in him and the lamp that I saw in those eyes was rest. And I found out that he was a preacher of righteousness. And when he preached it, I didn't get it. I was like, oh my gosh, dude, this is amazing. I have no idea what you're saying, but it's awesome. It was like being with Jesus. The disciples hung out with Jesus. They had no clue of what he was saying. None. They were like, dude, we were hanging with you. What did you mean? Really? They were like, we have no idea, but we really want to know. Like, when you said that, what exactly did you mean? Really? So you've got Jesus, who is this amazing teacher, who has this amazing authority, who is stomping devils constant, every day, all day long. It is bizarre. It's amazing. And he's like, by the way, you guys can go do it too. They're like, really? Awesome. Lord, you should have seen it. This is amazing. Look at all this stuff that happened. Woo! Jesus is like, don't rejoice in this. They're like, why? We had authority. It was awesome. Rah! Rejoice that your name is written. But they were still orphans. Crazy, man. Are you with me? I hope this is making some kind of sense. So Matthew 6:33 says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And it's right on the biggest chapter of worry. It's right at the end of the biggest chapter of worry in the Bible that I've read. Don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. But, seek first. Okay, that means that every Christian is supposed to seek it first. But unfortunately, we seek a lot of things. Seek first the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom? Well, Jesus defines the kingdom in Romans 14:17. And he says, the kingdom of God is neither meat nor drink, but is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So the kingdom is in the Holy Spirit. So the revelation of the kingdom is all in the Holy Spirit, who is the kingdom. So, but in him is righteousness, peace, and joy. So the kingdom is the Holy Spirit. And the kingdom, and Jesus says, you know what? That don't listen to people when they say, here's the kingdom there, or there's the kingdom here. Jesus is he goes, but I tell you, the kingdom is within you. Amen. So within means in the midst of, which means where you are, who you are. When you come to Christ, the kingdom comes to make his home inside of you, surround you, and be every part of you. But it's all in the Holy Spirit. Are you with me? But without relationship with the Holy Spirit, there is no revelation of righteousness. And you will come to Jesus and you will have peace for a momentary lapse of time. And then you will spend your whole lifetime trying to strive to get back in that place instead of learning straight from Jesus and maintaining and living in that place. This is really, really important. Are you with me still, kinda? So he says, come to me, all of you who are burdened down and weighed down, and I'll give you rest. So people are like, all right, amen. Praise God. Let's go get another one saved. But the problem is that person that's saved is saved enough for Jesus to forgive them of sins, but they never come to the knowledge of really being forgiven. So they have this memory and regret that produces death. And all the times that I travel, I'm like, people come to Christ and they're like, yay, yes, Jesus. And then they can't get over the things they wish they never did. Come on, man. This is like huge. So all my life, I hurt people. I destroyed people. I did all that stuff. And if I would have just come to Jesus and be like, God, thank you for forgiving me for my sin. The reality of not understanding who I am and not seeking first the kingdom, Holy Spirit, who is the revelation of righteousness, all the things will never be added to me. And I will always seek to strive to get things by my works instead of living in what has been given to me by my Father because I'm in rest. All right. So I know it's confusing, but it's good. Okay, go to Hebrews 3. All right. So, after I got saved, I'm in my bedroom, I'm seeking God. For those of you that don't know, I believe that God wanted to heal people a couple weeks after I got saved. And so, because I went to a healing service, I saw somebody get healed, and I was like, oh my gosh, dude, you're kidding me. And my response was, like, this is part of this? Because I didn't understand. I was just like, free, I'm free. I was free from all my past. Like, when I got saved, the blood of Jesus came, and he cleansed my conscience from dead works in order to serve God. And literally, my conscience got washed by the only substance that can clean it, which is the blood of Jesus. It's in Hebrews 9. He cleansed my conscience, so my mind, my will, my emotions, my past literally got wiped and washed away. And God forbid me from ever trying to dig it up again. Because digging it up is not believing that the blood was enough. That's what he shared with me. Like, people are like, well, I don't agree with that. Well, the Bible speaks different. If God forgave something and forgot it, would he ever dig it up again? No, but with the devil. You cannot have rest for your soul unless you learn from Jesus. And since Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and he says that when he forgives you, he forgets it, why would he dig it up again? Regret is looking back and trying to fix something that you can't. Regret, man, I can't believe I did that. Gosh, the devil says, yeah, well, what about this? And what about that? And what about this? And what about this? And he gets us punch drunk because we don't believe the gospel. Come on, man. Lots of people don't like this. Doesn't matter. I really am not here to make you happy. I'm here to see freedom. There's so many people that look back at their past and wish that they could change stuff and do stuff and fix stuff, but never get into here, learn from Jesus, and he dealt with your past. He crushed it. He annihilated it. You know, I have people come to me and tell me that I'm in denial. Christians, well, you're in denial. You're going to have to deal with this. My daughter was 7.5 years old when I got saved. And when I came home on that day and told her how sorry I was for all the junk that I had done, God had supernaturally erased her memory from all the junk and all the twisted stuff that I'd ever done. And there was a lot. Her mother kept her up on the couch for at least 5 years of her life while I was out on cocaine binges, telling her how much she hated me and how much her dad was a loser and a liar and a thief. Now she's leaving me. And when I got saved, I went to Teen Challenge and came home. My daughter had no memory of what I had done. She didn't remember one, I hate your father, your father's a loser. She didn't remember one job loss, and there were 30 in her lifetime. Me stole all money from our bank account. My daughter can't remember any of it. She's 18 today and still has no memory. But we have psychologically explained the blood away and tried to understand it. And we've said, no, 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 you have to use wisdom. Come on, she's going to have to deal with that stuff because they're buried things that are going to have to come out one day. And what we do in people's lives is we go fishing to try to find a reason why they're not free. And then we come up with nothing and we cause them to look into a closet to put flesh on dead bones. Because once you go into that closet, it's a never-ending source for the devil to try to put flesh on bones that are not supposed to live. And then all of a sudden, there's another thing, and then 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 there's this other thing. What about that other thing? What about when I was in the womb? I'm so sick and tired of hearing that. It breaks my heart that we would go back into our mother's womb to try to fix ourselves because our mom rejected us in there. Come on, man. What are we doing? I just had an email yesterday. Someone told me that I was molested when I was 5, but I have no memory of it, but obviously it must have happened. What is that stuff? Well, there has to be a reason why I'm messed up. That obviously is it, because this person is prophetic and knows way more than I do. Can't stand it. Makes me sick, man. Breaks my heart that we're going to sit there and we're going to say, well, there has to be a reason. I'm going to go searching for it. I'm going to go fishing for it. And we try to make people codependent on us so that they can stay free. And each year I've got to go meet with that person in order to maintain my freedom. But because we can't learn from Jesus and we can't go in here and just believe the truth of the gospel. And all of a sudden, there's another reason, and there's another reason. All of a sudden, I have some issue come up. Well, obviously, I didn't deal with this. And we go back into a life before Jesus ever came into our life, and we try to fix that thing. It says, he who looks back isn't even fit for the kingdom. Because the devil is back there. And if you look back, you can't steer straight. You can't plow straight. You're plowing in circles. The Bible says in Romans 8 that I am persuaded that neither angels nor principalities nor powers nor life nor death nor things present nor things to come nor any other created thing shall be able to separate me from receiving the love of God that's in Christ Jesus. But there's one thing that's not on that list, and that thing is your past, because your past has the ability to separate you from receiving the love of God that's in Christ Jesus. So many people can't get over the things that they wish they'd never done. But we never get into this thing and learn from the Christ himself, who says that all things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And we've explained that away psychologically. And says, I know that's what he says in theory, but you have to deal with this or you'll never be free. And people told me, Todd, you grew up in the Masonic homes. You were raised by the Masons. There's curses that are on your life that you have to fix. You have to deal with. And I read my Bible. I remember our pastor told me, he said, Todd, you can never really be free unless you go through these things in order to get the hooks and the twists and all that stuff out. And the simple gospel in my life was, well, what kind of hook could be there? Since I changed bloodlines, how can a generational curse follow through that bloodline? That's just the simple gospel. And I'm not preaching against anybody. I'm just boldly proclaiming the truth from the rooftops, because it's the only truth that I see in the Bible. The truth is that Jesus really set me free. And whom the Son sets free is free. It's not who psychology sets free is free. It's not whom a deliverance ministry sets free is free. It's whom the Son sets free is free. Amen. And sometimes people have ministries because they need to find the niche that's in their life. And if I'm preaching the finished work of Christ and your ministry is violated by what I'm preaching, you ought not have one. You ought not have a ministry if what I'm preaching violates what you found your niche in. And I'm not mean, and I'm not mad, and I'm not angry. I believe that Jesus is the only answer. There is no plan B, it's only plan A. And we've jumped through hoops that the devil has created in order for us to be free, but Jesus Christ is freedom. I'm not mad, but I can't stand lies, man. And people told me, well, Todd, you know, you're going to have to deal with these things. You're new and you've got a lot of zeal, but when that settles down, well, I've got news for you. What you see isn't just zeal. What you see is a passionate fire that burns. It will never go out, because nobody else can put junk on my flame, because the Lord has created a flame inside of me that is never, ever going to be quenched by lies, by worry, by fear, by anything. And nobody can take this away from me. Many people have tried. You can't even kill me and take this away from me, because the Bible says that if I believe in him, he's the resurrection and the life, and I will never die. So I don't fear death. I don't have a fear of it. There is absolutely no way that you could take this away from me. I don't care who you are. It doesn't matter. Teacher, president, nobody can take this away from me, because nobody else gave this to me but my King. So I'm with Dan, and I'm like, I'm hanging with him. I'm listening to what he's saying, and I'm like, oh my gosh, dude. And for 2 years, I worked full time, and I'm working all these hours, and I'd get home just in time to go to these meetings with Dan. And I would go Tuesdays and Thursdays and Saturdays. And I'm like, I'm just going to go. So I'd get home just enough time to take a shower, get in the car, we drive to the meeting. And I'm sitting there and I'm listening to him speak, and I'm like, I've never spoken. I've never ever gone with him so I could have a pulpit. I didn't try to just go there. I'm going to be in ministry, so I'm going to go with you. I'm going to learn from you. Then I'm going to be in ministry. I never thought that stuff. I loved my job. My job was amazing. It was fun for me to manifest Jesus to a world that didn't have him. I loved working. Didn't matter if I was in a dark place. That's where we belong. If you're a Christian and you're praying for people to give you a Christian job somewhere, you're deceived. You belong in the darkness, because light belongs in the darkness. But we better understand and see who we are, so that no matter where we go, that light manifests itself, because all creation is groaning for you to manifest sonship everywhere you go. And the groaning of people doesn't sound like you think it sounds. People think that creation groaning sounds like, yes, will you please show me who Jesus is? That's not groaning. Groaning is this: get away from me, I hate your guts, and I don't believe anything you say. Whatever, man. And inside of your heart, you could think, oh God, you're just groaning. This is amazing. Time to manifest Jesus. Time to never allow sin against you to produce sin within you. Because that's what the Bible says is truth. Nobody should have the right to provoke sin within you. Because it should be crushed. Because when sonship hits your consciousness, sin is no longer in you or a part of you. Even the thought of it repels your thinking. Because your thinking has been possessed by truth and you have peace with God even though you don't understand it. Peace, supernatural peace, that in the midst of horrible situations where everything's going crazy. Got me?
Yeah.
Thank you. Don't touch it. Don't touch it. Don't touch it. Gosh, I just have this explosion in my heart, man, that I can't shut it down. It's this burning fire that rages inside of me that doesn't like go away until I get it all out. So we might not eat lunch today. No, we will. We will. But we have to dive into this thing and realize that we need intimacy and we need to learn from our Father. So I never tried or strive to get into ministry. I strive to just stay in a place of relationship and be in love with God. And so I'm learning from Dan as he speaks. And I'm every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday, I'm going to these meetings. And we go to this one meeting. And I remember getting there and he starts to read and... He goes, you know, he goes, on the way down here, he goes, I really heard in my heart that Todd's supposed to share his heart tonight. Well, God didn't tell me that I was supposed to share my heart tonight. So I was not prepared. And then Dan goes, and I didn't want him to prepare. And I'm thinking, dude. And I would sit with him when he would speak. I'd just be right beside him listening. But all the while, for the last 2 years of my life, I've been learning who my Father is in my bedroom. See, because when I started to pray for people to be healed and all that stuff, my wife told me she'd never go in public with me again. This woman that loved me, and this woman was my best friend ever, but 2 weeks into our new marriage, I'm talking 9 years of the twisted, most horrible life, going to Teen Challenge for 2 months, coming home, and 4 days later, us getting married in between first and second service. Like, ridiculous. 2 weeks after that, I saw somebody get healed about a week and a half in, and I just started to pray for people. So we're at Walmart, and I see somebody with a walker, and I start to pray for them, and no one's getting healed. For real. And that first day in the store, she's in the car so angry at me. She can't believe that I'm doing this, and who do I think I am? Because she doesn't have a revelation that I'm getting. And I can't expect her to see it. See, I believe that I would just walk this out and that she would, and see, instead of trying to sell our fruit, we should just let people pick it. Because your tree will bear fruit and they'll just pick it. You don't have to try to sell it to them. Just let them pick it. But when they don't understand, they'll pick at you. And they'll persecute and all that stuff. So in 2 weeks, she wouldn't go. She said, I will never go in public with you again. I can't stand to be out of this house with you. I will never go outside again with you ever. And she went to church with me on Sunday because I was forbidden by the church to pray for anybody. And they're not my problem. So I didn't leave. I stayed there. People were like, well, I'd have gone somewhere else where I'd have been free to pray for people. Well, who's going to stop me in Walmart? Nobody. You need to have a voice in your church and have a pulpit at your church in order to be there. See, so many people go from church to church to church to try to get loved. But you're not supposed to go to church to get loved. You're supposed to become love and plug in somewhere. Come on, people get hurt by the church. They're like, you don't understand what they did to me. They didn't appreciate me. And all of a sudden, we've got attitude because the church didn't appreciate you and put you in a position that you thought that you deserved. Because you don't get your value from God. You're getting your value from your pastor. You're getting your value from your people at church, whether they value you or not. So we don't live in that relationship place where we already have our value from our Father. And sometimes people, they just don't understand. But if you understand what you're not supposed to understand, peace. No one can take away what they never gave you. I hope this makes sense. So I'm with Dan. He goes, you're supposed to share, Todd's supposed to share his heart tonight. And I'm thinking, okay. So I told everybody, I said, I want everybody to go to Hebrews 3. And when I got there, I realized, I thought it was something I'd read before. But when I got there, I realized I never read it. Ever. I've been 2 years in Christ and never read this. And it's crazy because, like, I haven't read the whole Bible right now, and I'm 11 years old. People are like, well, how can you preach? That's wrong. It's hard for me to read a lot at the same time. I just can't. But what I read, I want to become. So I chew on it and live in it and, like, God. So this is the scripture. I told everybody, go to Hebrews 3:8, and everybody's there already. So now 40-some people had turned there. And I'm like, I'm in trouble. But it was weird. This sense of peace just came right there when worry should have hit me hard, dude. Because I told a bunch of people to go to somewhere where they probably already read. I'd never even seen before. And it said, don't harden your hearts as in the day of rebellion, in the day of trial in the wilderness. For where your fathers tested me and tried me, and I just read and saw my works for 40 years. Therefore, I was angry with that generation and said, they will always go astray in their heart. They have not known my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. And I was looking, even today, I looked in the concordance, right? And I'm like, okay. So let me get this real quick again. Sorry, I'm slow. This is really good for me. It says reposing down, that word rest, the definition of it, it's katapausis, I think that's what it is. I'm not a real Hebrew Greek guy, but I have a concordance that if I touch a word, it explains it to me. It's pretty awesome. Really. And then I looked at it, and it the derivative of this word, it says to settle down, to colonize. And I thought in my heart, oh my gosh. Like faith, the word faith is I think it's pistis is the Greek word. But it means, it gives an example, and it says a town or a house with no empty rooms. Or a town with no empty houses. And then I put this colonize and this faith together just today, just a couple minutes ago. It was pretty cool. And it means to me that my soul is supposed to be so colonized with heaven, so possessed with full trust in my Father, because that's actually what it means. It means to trust in. And it was neat because Dave actually talked about it even in offerings and stuff. But more than that, your life is supposed to be an offering. But your life can't be an offering if you don't trust in your Father. So it says, come to me and I will give you rest in Matthew 11:28. And then you will find rest for your souls is in the next part of that. But that rest for your souls is different than the first rest. The second rest is like a recreation for your soul, a recreation for this right here. If you look in Peter and in Timothy and all these books, he talks about actually salvation of your soul being the finishing of your faith. So the salvation of your soul is actually the complete sanctification of your mind, will, and emotions to where your thoughts think about nothing but heaven's thoughts on a constant basis. And that is what it means to be led by the Spirit and to be a son. But we have to think like heaven thinks on a constant basis. So he says this, and he's like, today, if you wouldn't, if you wouldn't harden your hearts as in the day of rebellion. And it talks about rest. And I'm like, okay, this is like amazing. In the day of trial, it says, beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelieving in departing from the living God, but exhort one another daily while it is called today. This is Hebrews 3:13. Lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. So the deceitfulness of sin that he's talking about right here. And if you read in Hebrews all the way up through Hebrews 10, Hebrews 11, to the chapter of faith, and you get up through, he's talking about unbelief in the simplicity of the cross. So that unbelief causes our heart to be hard. So the deceitfulness of sin is actually a lack of faith in the true power of the blood of Jesus and the reality. Because back in Hebrews, when all this stuff happened, you know, you had the people that were in their tents, and every morning they'd wake up and there was manna outside their tent. There was enough for their day to eat. And if they stored it, it turned into worms, because God wanted to provide for them daily. But that manna wasn't just bread that came from the Father. It was Jesus in front of their tent every day. Jesus says, I'm the bread that came down from heaven. Your fathers ate manna in the wilderness, but it wasn't Moses that gave you that. It was my Father. And he's like, you know what? I was the bread that came down from heaven. I'm the bread. I'm the living bread. And they're like, what? Jesus is like, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have nothing in me. They wanted to kill him, like he's a cannibal, but he's not. He's saying, unless I'm everything to you, you will never make it. It's not just communion. It's not just eating the bread and drinking the juice. It's Jesus is everything. It's the simple understanding and belief system that the cross provided everything that we have, everything. Everything. The blood of Jesus. See, the blood of Jesus cleansing your conscience from dead works. It's the power. Like, we sing this. What can wash away my sin? Come on. What can make me whole again? Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fountain I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. That's the truth. We sing it with passion. We sing it with tears sometimes. Yet when we look in the mirror, we don't believe it. Do we really believe that it washes away our sin? Do we really believe that we can have peace with God? Do we really believe that we can maintain that peace with God? Well, the simple substance is the blood of Jesus. The manna outside of their tent was Jesus. The reality of the rock that followed them around in the wilderness that let water out of it was Christ. That rock was Christ. And they were in rebellion because they didn't trust in their Father to be a provider. I'm not just talking about full vats and barns and cars and houses. I'm talking about your simple everyday reliance upon Jesus to be your everything, your provider. Then he gives you peace that surpasses understanding. But unless you put your faith in the reality of the finished work of Christ, your past will always have a voice in your life. And you won't get to things present because you're constantly looking behind you. True forgiveness is only in Christ, and there's no way for Todd White to live one day without him. There's only plan A. It's only Jesus. So what could be easier? You revisiting 5,000 things that you wish you never did, or you believing the finished work of Christ? See, well, I understand it. People say, well, there's a process to get to there. No, the process isn't to the cross. The process is from the cross. Because if the process is to the cross, you'll never get there. The devil will always have something else that you need to deal with in order for you to be free. And we've put the body of Christ in this dilemma. We've told her that she can never truly get free until Jesus returns. Well, I've got news for you. That's not true, and that's not in your Bible. God will always work in you, and he'll always be doing things and perfecting things and fine-tuning everything. But if we don't live from the simple rest, we will constantly be trying to get things out of the way so we can enter into it.
But that's not true. Jesus is the narrow way. There is a narrow way that leads to life. Many are called, but few find it. That's a problem. That's a problem. Many are called, but few find it. Narrow is the way that leads to life. What is life? Jesus is life. He's the way, the truth, and the life. It's not no one comes to heaven except by him. It's no one comes to the Father except by him. Because it's relationship with the Father as a son, so that you can live as a son, destroying hell for a living, not thinking like hell, and doing things in order to maintain this thing. You believe the truth so that you can live in this thing, so that you can stomp hell. You can look in the mirror and like what you see. You can like your value. You can see who God created you to be. You don't have to do things to gain his love. You live from his love, but his love is revealed on a tree. God loved us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Man, when you were a sinner, when you were as twisted up as could be, Christ died for you. I love my job. People call me an evangelist. I guess that's what I might be. But my job is to equip the saints, not the sinners, for the works of ministry. But if you don't understand rest, you'll always be falling short of the very thing that Jesus paid a price for you to become. Are you guys okay? Look, for who having heard, it says partakers of Christ, I think beware brethren lest, let me just read this again, verse 12, beware brethren lest there be in you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God, but exhort one another daily while it is today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. While it is said, today if you hear his voice, don't harden your hearts as in the day of rebellion. For who, having heard, rebelled? Indeed, was it not all who came out of Egypt, led by Moses? Now with whom was he angry for 40 years? Was it not those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? To whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey? So we see that they could not enter in because of their unbelief. Then it says, therefore, since a promise remains of entering his rest, let us fear lest any of us has fallen short of it. For indeed, the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those that heard it. For we who have believed do enter that rest. For it said, I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he has spoken in a certain place on the seventh day. God rested on the seventh day from all of his works. And again in this place, they shall not enter into my rest. So it goes into here. And it talks about, therefore, there remains a rest for the people of God. Verse 9. For he who has entered his rest has himself ceased from his works as God did from his. Let us therefore be diligent to enter into his rest. Look at this. Lest anyone fall short according to the same example of disobedience. How can you have the same example of disobedience? The same example of disobedience is not obedience in the simplicity of the gospel. And it goes into Hebrews 4:12, which is amazing scripture. It says, for God's word is alive and sharp and active, able to divide and separate the soul from the spirit, the joint from the marrow, and he judges the thoughts and intents of the heart. So what happens is God's first place that his word, when we learn from Jesus and we take his yoke upon us and we learn from him, for he's meek and gentle and lowly at heart. When we learn from him, the first place that the word of God comes to do is he slices and dices and separates your soul from your spirit, man. And the way that seems right to a man is cut off. The way that seems right to a man is the broad road. It's not just people that are of different religions and different faiths. The broad road leads to destruction. Narrow is the way that leads to life. Listen, there's a lots of ways that seem right to a man, and there's lots of feelings that people bring into their hearts as the truth, but those are feelings. They are not the truth. But God's word comes and divides and separates. And I want to encourage you to not just listen to everybody else's teaching, but to learn from Jesus and to ask him. Jesus paid a price to establish a rest for the body of Christ that nothing else in the whole world can give you. But if you have an unbelief in the finished work of Christ, it will be to be continued. Jesus says it's finished. So your works in order to get to the Father was finished on Calvary, and sin was nailed to him on the tree, so much that he that knew no sin became sin. And the only way to have peace with God is to understand what right standing means. When Jesus was on that tree, there was nobody that walked out the reality of the law. Nobody. 613 laws and 10 commandments. Lots of people say, well, Todd, you have an amazing testimony. I grew up in the church. That's self-righteousness. Self-righteousness says, I was a pretty good person and you're a really bad person. And you compare yourself one amongst each other and you say, well, he has an amazing testimony. He was twisted. And the reason why he loves so much is because he's been forgiven much. And you limit yourself and think that because you, self-righteously thinking that you weren't as bad as me, have the right to not love. And all of you have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But God took you from that place and put you into sonship. He forgave you of everything. And if you would see just how much you've been forgiven, peace would hit your soul and you would live from love itself instead of having an excuse to not love. People say, well, that woman, I mean, she had lots of sin. Jesus said she was forgiven much, so she loves much. Todd, you were the same way. You had lots of sin, like as if like the Pharisees didn't. The truth is we don't realize how much we've been forgiven. Why? Because we keep revisiting our past and believe the devil instead of the Lord. And so we can't love because we keep thinking about things we wish we'd never did because we don't believe the cross and we don't believe the rest that God gave us. And we don't believe the blood of Jesus is enough and we think that we need psychology to set us free instead of supernaturalology and the blood of Jesus, cleansing our conscience, washing all the dead works away so that we can live completely abandoned to this God of love that paid a price to set our soul free from all that stress and striving and enter into his rest where we could live from. And it's not about getting to the process to the cross. It's about living in the process from the cross where God works out your salvation with fear and trembling. And he annihilates and crushes things that don't belong because the Holy Spirit convicts you of your righteousness, which crushes the ability to want to sin. Because when you're convicted of your right standing with God, it's first and foremost everything that you are, and anything that comes against that has to go. And then all of a sudden you live in this purity of heart to where you see the Father, you come boldly to the throne room. Because you always need grace in time of need, and you always need Jesus, and you always need grace. But real grace empowers the reality of the conviction of righteousness to be active in your life so that you don't ever try to sin and get away with it. Where you live in peace, and even the thought of sin violates your conscience, and you can't have that happen. So you live in such a way to where righteousness is actually training your soul and you're being trained in righteousness so that your senses become trained to discern between both good and evil. And when something is evil, because your conscience is being trained in righteousness, it's only two commandments. It's pretty amazing. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. There's only two. But when anything comes in violation of that, which would be your past, because your past doesn't exist. But when your past tries to whisper into your life the truth of who God says you are, the truth of being a new creation, every day produces a lifestyle of repentance to where your conscience remains soft. And every day you live in the constant ability to repent if need be. And if something comes and violates your conscience, because it violated your conscience, you don't willfully step in it. And if you make a mistake and you step in it, immediately the Holy Spirit convicts you. You confess to God, God, that's not who you created me to be. And it says that God is faithful and just to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. And the only thing that remains is right standing with the Father. I promise. And no situation, no job, no ministry, no life is worth it to go after that at the cost of this. And if this thing maintains, God will always provide. But Jesus needs to be your manna. Jesus needs to be your everything. I guess it's getting back to the simplicity of the gospel and that the cross is the truth of everything. And the price that was paid for you on that tree determines your value, and nothing else has the right to determine your value. No demeaning of somebody shall be able to take away the value that only Christ paid for you to have. Is this making any sense? Just put your hands on your head for me. Just kidding. We're like, Jesus, I thank you for perfect peace. I thank you for the simplicity of the gospel. God, you're amazing. Father, I ask you to let the cross be first and foremost in a life, God. God, I ask you for the rest that only comes from the gospel, that only comes from Jesus. Father, I thank you that even envy would be excommunicated from our brain. People say, Todd White, I wish I had your life. I wish I'm called to do what you do. All I am is normal. So what you're saying is you're called to be normal. So Father, I'm asking you in the name of Jesus to give people peace, the peace that surpasses understanding. God, I thank you that Jesus says, unless you become like a child, never get it. God, I thank you that my four-year-old, when she falls down and bumps her knee, and she sees her dad, she comes running to her dad, or she comes crying to her dad, and she believes that I'm going to help her. God, I'm asking you for you to become manna for us every day. That Jesus, we would rely upon you for perfect peace, and that we wouldn't rely upon stuff, things, finances, whatever. I thank you for rest, God. Jesus, you are awesome. God, thank you that we don't want to enter into unbelief when it comes to the cross. I'm asking you to straighten out our belief that the cross would be everything again. God, thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Go eat. Bless you.
Hey, guys. Thanks for watching the video. We came up with a website. It's called Lifestyle Christianity. We have our newsletter that's going to go out. You can sign up for our email list. We also have testimonies on there, event schedule, all that stuff. It'll be amazing. We want to empower a generation to walk Christianity as a lifestyle, so we can all walk with the power of God on a constant basis. It's going to be awesome. So come on over. Bless you. Thanks for watching.